representatives here. All right.
Yeah, there are many things to tell you about this past month at the high school. First of all, the winter sports season ended within the past month, and three sports finished up. There's swimming, basketball, and hockey. The basketball team, both the girls and the guys team, made the playoffs, and hockey also had a successful season. And swimming, the girls finished second in the state out of 16 schools, and the boys team finished third out of 16 schools on February 19th at the state meet, so they did very well. Second of all, the 29th of this month, which is 2 weeks from now, there'll be Fine Arts Night in the auditorium in the high school. Now what this is, is a general showing of the general types of art and music and theater that is going on currently at the high school. Last year, there was everything from a classical brass choir quintet to a jazz band to a play. You know, there is everything, and it was a very successful night, and it was highly recommended to attend if you enjoy that. Thirdly, the speech team won the state championship on March 5th at the high school. It was held here in Cape Elizabeth, and they won out of 18 schools. The speech team got about twice as many trophies as any other school that attended, so we really ran away with that, and we were very pleased. Next, the student council. The student council is planning, with the help of Mr. Miles, to try to revamp the system so that the students have a little bit more say in what goes on, and generally more of a will to get things done. In the past, the student council has really sat to wait until what the faculty and the administration does before they act. And what Mr. Miles would like to have done now is that the student council get more involved in having their goals first before the faculty or the administration acts, and not to act just as a mirror to the faculty or the administration. And what Mr. Miles would like to do now is have a student council retreat, and we would have this for one day in a church or basically anywhere where we can get a building, and have speakers and try to learn more about parliamentary procedure, for instance, and how to make our group the most effective governmental body that we can. So we're looking forward to that, and we should be planning that within the next student council meeting, which is a week from Monday. Now, and on the final note, the exchange trips to France and to Spain were held this past month. The France trip was held from February 9th to March 2nd, and the Spain trip left February 21st and just got back last night. And Brian can tell us about that. Brian was one of the participants in the group that went.
Under the supervision of Juan and the benevolence of all the families in Spain, Spain was just incredible. The families that we stayed with were really nice, and Juan took us to places like we saw the Royal Palace, we went to the Prado, went to Toledo, saw the Royal Chapel, and we went to Granada and saw the Alhambra. We went to Machuel. I went to a bullfight, a couple of soccer games, boxing match. It was amazing. It was a good time, and not much else to say. It was really successful and fun, and it worked well because usually he's used to going in April. And we went in February this year, and the weather was fabulous. It was like 75 degrees there. And I guess one day maybe it had a white snow, but otherwise not. It cleared up, but it was fun.
Thank you very much, both of you. Any questions, the high school representatives?
Good. I'm very pleased to hear the report. One of the things that you probably will report on next time. We also have a young person that's going to Russia,
yeah,
to Archangel.
Mm-hmm.
And in your backup today, it's for information, you'll see the program for the Russian Archangel. Also, the board, the Cumberland County Superintendents Association, is having a April 6th breakfast for board members who belong to the consortium. And we're going to do that at the Westbrook Vocational Institute. It's the tech, their tech school, at which time they will have four or five of the educators. So I'm hopeful that board members that are able to come would be able to come. You'll get a flyer from my secretary in the morning. Thank you. Mr. Chairman, can I go on to the first report this evening? Is the report on the 8th grade main educational assessment score. This time, you not only have Lyle Kramer, our own analyst, the statewide analyst is done by the commissioner, and that is attached, and I was able to get that very recently. Also, the Sunday papers carried a great deal on this, and I'll let Lyle make his formal report. Mr. Kramer.
Thank you. What I'll do this year is like I have done in the past. I will briefly go through the report, touch upon the important pages and pointing out what I think is significant. I'd like to start on page 3 where it shows the numbers of students who were included in our report. And one of the reasons that I think has taken on a little bit more significance this year is because at least one school in the state had the results thrown out or discarded because they excluded like 20% of the kids. We've been accused in some parts of attempting those similar kinds of things. So when I make my report, I like to point out to you folks that we excluded only one student out of 100. And because one student didn't do a significant part of a test that was thrown out, and then another student's reading sample somewhere along the line was misplaced. So there were a total of 3 students not included, 1 intentionally, 2 accidentally on the part of someone. That means that we ended up with 96 of our students being tested, 96 out of 99. The state percentage of students who are included in scores is 94, and ours was 97. So if anyone asks you how many of our kids were tested, you can say that they were, that 97% of our kids were tested and included in the report. And that's well above the state average for students to be included. Going on to page 5, this is a breakdown of the percentage of students that score in the 4 quarters of other scores across the state. We periodically have students fluctuate from one quartile to another in those areas. And it's very difficult, I think, to pick out any distinct patterns there. If you folks have any questions, I'll be happy to try to address those. But there's a certain amount of flow from one quartile to another from year to year. And overall, they remain pretty consistent. But you will have yearly fluctuations there. I think page 7 is the key page. And that's where our scores are listed for this year. They are listed for this year in comparison to an expected score band. And then we have a cumulative score for the 3 years. You'll notice in Commissioner Byther's report, she puts a lot of emphasis on the cumulative scores for the past 3 years. If you go to reading, for instance, our expected score band is 345 to 395, and our reading scores for this year was 395 with a 3-year total of 375, or a 3-year average, I should say. If you move to the writing area, our expected band was 340 to 390, and our score was 390. If you go to the math subtest, 3 years in a row, we've received 400 scores. That's the absolutely top score. So our yearly score is 400. Cumulative 3 year was 400. And they didn't put in an expected score band because we're expected to score at the top in that subtest. In science, the score band that's expected is 315 to 365, and we scored at 370, with a three-year cumulative average of 80. In social studies, the expected score band is 355 to 400. I received a 400 score this year, and a cumulative 395 for the 3 years. In the humanities area, our band was 370 to 400, and we received a 400 score there. In every situation, we scored either at the very top range, the top extreme of our expected score band, or we exceeded the score that is to be expected for communities like ours. Any questions about any of those scores? The next two pages are very difficult to, very difficult for us to gain any significant information from, because they are pretty consistent and pretty consistent towards the top. One that does show up as being fairly average is the main studies part of the social studies test. And one of the reasons for that is the amount of main studies that we do just is covered in the eighth grade, in the eighth grade U.S. history section of the social studies curriculum. And they don't get to that by the 1st of November when these tests are given. However, you'll note too that overall we scored a 400. That was in spite of not having had any main history at that point from the eighth grade curriculum. Then if you move over to pages 12 and 13, I'm sure you folks have all read about it and discussed, we've discussed here many times, the gender gap. And the any gender gap that's existent now is certainly not typical, because the girls scored perfect, or not perfect scores, but they received the top scores in five of the six categories and outscored the boys in every single category. For the people who don't have these reports, in reading, boys scored 375, girls 400. In writing, boys 352, girls 400. Math, boys and girls both scored 400. In science, boys 369 and girls 373. In social studies, both sexes scored 400. In humanities, the boys scored 361 and the girls 400. And at the same time, while I'm talking about this, I don't want you folks to think that the boys did too poorly either, because those boys' scores are about equal to what we often score, the scores that we often receive as a school. So I think that the boys have done as well as ever. It's just that we have an exceptionally hardworking and good group of girls in our eighth grade this year. So I wouldn't take anything away from the boys, but I give a lot of credit to the girls. In the gift and talented program, most of those students score 400 across the board. That's true now. Another place where we improved a lot over last year's scores is in the area of special education. 9% of our students have an IEP and receive some kind of special services. As a whole, that group score as well as some schools score. And in the area of science and social studies, our special services students received almost average scores for the state.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
I was very pleased with those special education scores, the handicap scores. I was surprised that the one score that seemed to be low was in, universally low, was in math. And I was wondering if that had been recognized, if there was maybe some reason for that.
I just, one comment that I would have is that a significant amount of our special services involves the language arts area. And not a lot of students receive much extra help in the area of math.
It looks like that might be a great help to some of those people. If the other scores can be significantly higher, that's the one score that's very low. So I think that's something that administration might want to look into.
And even though the special education scores were very strong, you can see that when you look at our non-special education population, five out of six scores are 400, and one score is 390. I guess that touches on the highlights of the report. If you folks have any questions generally, I'd be happy to attempt to address them.
Any questions?
I have one question. Lyle, in your comments, you say that while our scores are high, I feel compelled to suggest that as our school moves towards a hand-on, experience-based curriculum and away from textbook curriculum, we will see a decline in standardized test scores. Commissioner Byther, in her memorandum on these tests, says, students who attended schools identified as being closely aligned with the, quote, middle school, unquote, philosophy, tended to score higher than those attending schools with the more traditional junior high philosophy. Now, there appears to be a difference of opinion, and I wonder if you could comment on that.
There certainly is a difference of opinion there, and I guess only history is going to say who's right and who's wrong. I'd like to point out that the questionnaire asked how many principals or how many schools saw themselves as middle schools and following a middle school philosophy. I suspect that there were an awful lot of middle schools reported who have a lot of more traditional junior high school kinds of curriculums going on within the middle school structure, number one. Number two, the difference that she points out is 10 points in writing and 20 or more points in reading, math, science, and humanities. When you look at the amount of difference in score there, keep in mind that just the difference between boys and girls can produce as much as 100 points difference. So I don't see a significant difference there. And she also goes on to point out that we need to further examine the philosophy and instructional practices. And I think that along with that, as we need some research into why. And before we make too many statements like that, we need to know what is middle school and what's being measured and what is not. I think that there's another interesting point that she makes in here, and I think that this, I think, applies not only to the science area, but to the experiential-based kind of curriculum versus a textbook curriculum. In the science area, she pointed out that the students who score the highest in science are the ones who spend about half of the time working with hands-on kinds of educational experiences. If the kids spend less than that amount of time, the scores go down. If they spend more than that amount of time, the scores go down. And I suspect that the same thing applies to curriculum across the board, so that a little bit to an average amount is great. Too much gets you to a point of diminishing returns, and the scores start going the other way. So I think that is a key point.
I think this is being recognized by the legislature, who has appropriated some money to have a commission review the assessment, the beginnings of the assessment. Now, I happen to think that when they study this in depth, they're going to change the test to reflect some of the changes that we've made, particularly in higher level thinking skills. Now, that remains to be seen, but I would hope that in a year from now, we'll see. However, it's always nice to be where we would hope we are, and it certainly says an awful lot for, number one, the intellectual ability of our young people, and secondly, the staff, without a doubt.
I just wanted to make a comment. I noticed there are about 20 to 25 young people out in the audience tonight, and I think I recognize most of you as ninth graders. Is that right? How many of you are ninth graders? OK, You're the people that we're talking about tonight. This is the test that you took last year in eighth grade. So, yes.
Yes, that's...
Yes, you're the ones.
No, those were the kids whose scores were reported last year. This is for the current eighth grade who took this test this past November.
You did good, too.
Any other questions or comments?
Thank you, Ron. Mr. Chairman, can I go right on?
Yeah.
All right. We've had two meetings where we've discussed the organization of schools for next year. And I'd like to formally recommend this evening that we move on the following. That we organize the schools on a K-5 and a 6-8 basis, and that we provide a full-time administrator and an assistant administrator for 750 or more on the K-5 level. And moreover, that we make every attempt to secure funds from cuts elsewhere in the budget from both staff and present administrative or quasi-administration. While we're working on the budget, I'd hope that the personnel in the middle school, along with the principal, would study the total implications of the design and development of a true middle school concept, the kind that the Commissioner Byther is talking about, for the future, and present to the board next spring a complete package prior to budget time, in as much as there would be possible implications for monies. I think this has been discussed at length, and if the board buys this recommendation, we could move on it while we're doing budget deliberations.
While the board has met in workshop sessions, there certainly is not as much sun shining on those sessions as there is on this one, and I think more people in the community probably aware of what happens at a school board meeting than they are what happens at a school workshop. So I think it would be helpful to people watching at home, Darryl, if you were to tell them how this is going to be set up. That is, why we're doing this, what the problem is. Does it mean that we're going to have extra or additional administrators? Are we spending more money on administration next year? I could do it, but I think you're better equipped to do it.
I'd be more than happy. First of all, to go back to several workshop meetings, we've looked at several alternatives to plan facilities for hopefully the next 5 years that would allow us enough flexibility to manage the enrollments, which are growing at the elementary level and declining on the secondary level. And we'll be talking about that a little later this evening. We looked at every conceivable possibility, from the NESDEC study to building millions of dollars worth of bricks and mortar to portables. It was our decision with the board that we would use these interim years, we would use the portable concept, which is primarily paid for by the state for communities that are going through this very kind of enrollment fluctuations. As you know, we have a nice facility at the elementary school that has a media center and several smaller rooms. We're recommending for next year a 70 by 70 portable that would house the media center and also the computer center. And by doing that, we are freeing up 5 classrooms that are presently in the middle school. Now, we're going to be adding additional classes next year from grades 3-8, and that'll be presented at our next meeting when we talk about people. At the same time, the state has done a number of studies, particularly last year, on a middle school concept, and we're one of 5 states that probably has been aggressive as well as progressive as to looking at middle school concepts and what to do with young people at that age bracket. Now, that's really in tune and in line with what we like to think is the leading trend philosophy in the country. So what we're trying to do is to study the whole concept of the middle school to see if that's the way we want to go. And secondly, we would like the fourth and fifth graders to be identified and aligned a little more closely with what we normally think is an elementary school. And we would like, particularly now that we're doing so much work in curriculum, and we want the curriculum sequence to run from K through 5. And it's an ideal time to philosophically reorganize the schools along these lines. A K-5, which will be over 700 youngsters, a smaller middle school, and a high school that is going to be around 400. We've lost over 100 there. And in 3 years, we'll probably grow again. So our workshops have been around the organization of the schools, how we're going to design and develop the curriculum with a curriculum director and some people who are working on curriculum, and lastly, form follows function, the kind of space we could put those people in. If this all holds true, I would hope, unless something drastic happens to this community, that we could live with our facilities for 5 years and concentrate on the philosophical base of the whole educational process. So basically, Mr. Chairman, I think that's the work we've been doing that people don't see, and we report on very hastily at board meetings such as this.
Am I correct that that all this is precipitated because the Pond Cove School is simply not large enough to accommodate the numbers of students that are now in the elementary grades, which are considerably more students than we had 3 and 4 and 5 years ago in Pond Cove School?
Yeah, primarily, that's our problem. We, you know, naturally, we looked at what we could do to Pond Cove to put fourth and fifth graders there. You can't build up on Pond Cove. The specs are such that you can't do that. I don't have to tell you that you can't put additions on because you'd be in the road. So we're hampered by the facilities. There's no doubt about it. I think if we all had our way, we'd like K-5 to be all at one spot. At the same time, we have to look at the realities. For 4 through 5, which we hope is an extension of the elementary school, we'll be using the old high school. And it's there, and it's a facility. We're going to do a lot of repair work there this year because that school is quite old. However, it's still functional, and we can make those repairs and organize it so it really becomes a K-5. That's why we want two people running the whole 750. Now, that's quite justifiable in terms of numbers in this state or any state, from my point of view.
Now, in what way, can you explain in what way there'll be a distinction between 6, 7, and 8 and 4 and 5, which for all intents and purposes, they'll be in connected buildings over there, the old high school and the middle school. They're going to be in a cafeteria at the same time. There's only one cafeteria over there. They're going to have, you know, breaks or recesses at the same time. They're going to be on the same playground. Bus schedules, things of that sort.
We're thinking at this point, and we're just working on this presently, we're thinking that the K-5 population would be the same schedule. However, the fourth and fifth graders are going to have to use some of the facilities of the middle school. Now, by having them on the, and these are the technical aspects that we're working up, by having them on the same schedule as Pond Cove, we can work with the teachers more easily, where teachers can meet to work on curriculum. And at the same time, I want you to think about this. If we're on different schedules, we automatically enlarge the school. And that's one of the cheapest ways to enlarge a school. It's like adding another period to the school. And if you do that, you can almost add a 12th of the square footage. Now, that's, we haven't fulfilled that design yet. We're working on it presently. If the school starts earlier or later and goes a little later or earlier, the hours, of course, will be the same, but they'll be staggered a little bit, which will help us on the facilities that are tough, e.g., the art room. One art room is, you know, is small for that kind of population. The gym. However, we do get a pretty fair spring and a pretty fair fall, and our outside facilities are, you know, superb. So we will probably have to work around the winter years a little more carefully, a little more highly scheduled. The computer room, our new one, certainly would be ample for that population, and we emphasize the computer at one stage rather than another, so we can diminish that. The cafeteria, of course, will always present a problem to us. However, I have yet to, I hate to say this, but I have yet to find that that's a high value in this community. As long as it's adequate and some kids brown bag it, and Laura, pardon this, D, a good majority of the youngsters are always complaining about the food anyway. I think we'll have another 10 years of the same kind of cafeteria that we have, until that becomes a real high value.
Well, it's been there for 50 years, so I guess you go a lot longer.
Except the D has got numerous plans to refurbish that, so it, you know, the paint doesn't come off the wall and a few things like that.
Darryl, I'm just asking questions to elicit information for some of the people who are involved, and we'll get an opportunity to ask questions in a minute. I just had a couple of other questions. One is, you said you're going to make an attempt to secure funds from existing administrative accounts. Now, will this, are you recommending a full-time assistant principal for the Pond Cove School?
Yes.
Is there any assistance there now in the Pond Cove School with the principal? Is she the only administrator?
No, there are two quasi-administrators, as well as 11 people are empowered to make the decisions. And it's our feeling that we would do something like the following. We would put a full-time assistant and a full-time principal, and we would cut out a large number of quasi-administrators that have and do receive stipends that range from $1,500 to $3,500 and even $4,500. And we would take a hard look at those quasi-administrative positions. I think what has happened here is that over the years, our priorities have changed. And we're changing dramatically the quasi-administrative positions in favor of curriculum work and pedagogy. Now, let me explain that. Effective schools research in the last 5 years has helped us pinpoint where the high values are and where we can make a difference educationally. And I think we're starting to see now some of that by our testing and the testing that I'll present to you a little later. For example, I've just reported our SRAs for all of our grades for 2 years with the superintendent in Kennebunkport, who's working on a big study on testing. I'll share that with you when we get that finished. But our priorities have changed, where 10 years ago, I think most of the quasi-administrative jobs were organization and lunch money and a host of things that didn't, in my view, didn't add to the educational process. To pedagogy, staff development, and curriculum work, so that the basis of the school is far more educational. Now, I don't think we can afford to have both. So what we're asking the board is to let's change our priorities and let's cut those priorities that were there 10 years ago that we don't think are as effective.
Now, to make this clear, you're going to have a full-time assistant principal in the Pond Cove School. And in addition, what's not clear to everybody is that you are alluding in your talk here to some additional administrative positions, which will be curriculum positions.
Right.
To oversee curriculum changes in each of the schools. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Elementary, middle, and high school. So that those would be additional staff positions, three curriculum people who would be involved, and the assistant principal in the elementary school. Now, there are some people on the board who have said that you better get the money for that from existing administrative accounts. They see that as an opportunity for you simply to change the method of administrating the schools without increasing the amount of money spent on administration relative to other activities that the school department engages in. Now, I, for one, and I'm going to be quiet after this, but I just want to set this thing up. I, for one, favor that. That is, taking a fixed amount of money for administration and saying, how can we make our administration of the schools more efficient and more effective for using the same, essentially the same monies? So when I vote on this, it's going to be conditioned on you doing that, because what I don't want to do is wake up after the budget period is all over and find that all we've done is put on some more layers of administration.
That message has been quite clear. And what I'm saying is the superintendent is going to make every attempt to do that.
Well,
not to the penny, but pretty much I think it can be done with approximately the same amounts of money. And I think that's a fair statement. And I think it makes great sense that we put our money where our priorities are. Now, I'd be the first to say that it's going to hurt, because some people will not receive the stipends they have been receiving for maybe years. But in all fairness to the community, we should look at the priorities and put our money where the priorities are.
Further questions, Adele?
No, I just wanted to comment that I think everybody has worked very hard to do just that, to put the money where the priorities are and to not spend it on bricks and mortar and put up new buildings and so forth, but to really improve the educational system. And I really applaud that effort.
Well, that's in the form of a report, Darrell. Now, do you want us to approve the reorganization? We're going to deal with this in budget.
I would, but I would hope you would approve the concept of the reorganization so that I can start cutting and working.
Is there a motion?
I move that we accept the recommendation for reorganization of a K through 5 elementary school and a 6-8 middle school, and add to that motion the fact that the money is expended for this reorganization come from cost savings in other areas, as we've talked about.
Other areas of administration?
Other areas of administration.
Second.
Motion has been made and seconded. Make sure you get that. Right. That last part. All right, any further comments? All in favor, signify by raising your hand. All opposed, 5-0.
Well, Mr. Chairman, it appears that the ball is squarely in our court.
I think so.
The center of your court.
Yeah. That's never scared you, Darryl.
Not yet.
No.
The next item I'd like to report on is in line with the Homestead Committee report and its acceptance, I'd like to formally see the organization of the committee so that it could start work immediately. And I'm recommending the proposed Homestead Committee to look something like this. A school board member, Mr. Leslie, the superintendent of schools, Frank Miles, the high school principal, I would recommend that he be chairman, two language teachers to be selected by the high school principal, and the following parents who have volunteered their services: Sue Gabriel, Dawn Sanborn, Aline Jelanis, Joe Orphis, Bob Gordon, and Deborah Gordon. And I believe those are not the same family. There are different Gordons. Now, I'd like a resolution to formally launch this committee and ask the high school principal to call the first meeting as soon as possible.
Is there a motion to undertake this resolution to authorize the formation of the committee with these people on it and to begin their work?
Yes.
You have a conflict of interest.
If you notice, my hands are full.
Is there a second? Okay. Motion was made and seconded. And the resolution, as I understand it, is that the people in this who we've just listed be authorized to convene as a committee and to begin their activities in regulating the homestead program, and they will have responsibility for it. And we trust that from time to time, as needed, they will report to the school board on how things are going. I'm sure that that Peter will let the school board know how it's working out. I think this will be an interesting process. These are all volunteers, incidentally?
Yes, they all called
in. Nobody was drafted?
Nobody was drafted. All volunteers.
No, we'll vote. All in favor, signify by raising your right hand. Okay. All opposed? All right. Resolution is adopted and the committee is in existence. The rest is up to them.
And lastly, E is the citizen discussion of items not on the agenda.
Yeah, that really shouldn't come under your report. You're not reporting that the citizen...
I'm just trying to tell the chairman where we are.
And I know where we are. And actually, that comes under the superintendent's report on this agenda, so...
But we should move it.
We should not have it under the superintendent's report unless you want to speak for all the citizens out there.
No, I don't.
You probably know what's on their mind. Is there anybody in the audience that would like to comment on anything relating directly or indirectly to the schools? Well, apparently not. So we'll move along. Yes.
We do have one.
Oh, yeah. Peter? Would you come up to the microphone, Peter, and identify yourself once more?
I'm Peter Glasser, one of the high school representatives. And while we're speaking about the subject of reorganizing the schools, I know there have been a couple of rumors the past few years in the high school that maybe the eighth graders would be moving into the high school or the first graders and the kindergartners or something like that. And I would just like to know, for the benefit of the high school students, if that is still being considered or if it ever was considered.
Yes, so we very carefully considered every alternative that you just spoke of, moving the seventh and eighth grade to the high school, the eighth grade to the high school, and the kindergarten to the high school. And it was decided after several meetings that that was not the alternative. Those were not the alternatives to choose. So we would hope that we're going this way. K-5, middle school, and the high school will remain the way it is.
Okay, thank you.
Any other comments? The next item on the agenda is approval of the minutes of the regular meeting. Everybody has in their packet any changes, amendments? If not, entertain a motion to approve the minutes.
So moved.
Moved and seconded, all in favor, signify by raising your hand, all opposed, it's a vote. The next item is the business manager's report. This is not the time, you all have a copy of the report. I say this is not the time, this is not your...
It's not a quarterly, but if there's any questions.
Yeah, you all have a copy of the report, is there anything that you want to clear up with Dee?
You might notice school lunch report, page 2 of 2. School lunch will be addressed in the budget process. School lunch is running nick and tuck this year. Costs have risen, we're still charging the same prices for the kids for lunches and that. But we'll address this through the budget process. As to what, we get a few solutions we'd like to recommend to you people.
All right. Good. Next item on the agenda, item number 3 is an appointment to the Advisory Committee of Community Services. The Advisory Committee members are approved by the school board. Sue Weatherby has sent us a letter.
Chairman?
Yeah.
Could I intercede for a moment? I have a letter that I just received this evening.
Okay.
Adding another person for nomination for the board.
Okay.
And if I may, I'd like to read a paragraph on each of them. And they're recommended by the advisory committee, and it just came this evening. The recommendation is for Mrs. Londonderry, has 2 children in the Cape Elizabeth schools. Family has historically supported the community service program. Cindy is also a broker associated with Mark Simpson Realtor.
She's the nominee. Cindy Landrigan has been nominated, right?
Yes.
Okay, go ahead.
I feel that her daily contact with people in the community will enhance the commission's effort to continue to develop and implement program responding to the needs and interests of the citizenry. The second one is Mrs. Mitchell, and you do not have that. This letter came late today. Has been a former member of the commission and wishes to be reappointed. In accordance with the statement of policy regarding appointments to standing boards and commissions, her reappointment may occur after a 1-year period of non-service to that board. The Mitchells have 3 children in the Cape Elizabeth schools, and the entire family has been active in community service programs. She's enjoyed her tenure on the commission and is anxious to serve again.
All right, so 2 nominations.
2 nominations.
Mrs. Landrigan and Mrs. Mitchell. Any discussion?
There are 2 positions to be filled, am I correct?
Yes. And our director is here.
And she's nodded affirmatively that there are 2 positions. Okay. Any further discussion about these nominations? If not, is there a motion?
Yes, I move to nominate Cindy Landrigan and Sue Mitchell to the Community Services Advisory Committee.
And Mr. Leslie, I know this
seconded.
All in favor? All opposed? To vote. Next item is the superintendent has various nominations to make of continuing contract teachers, and then several other nominations. Why don't you go and describe what you're nominating people to, and then read the list in each category.
First, I want to say that this is probably the most important board meeting we have each year. This is when we look at the quality of our personnel who are going to remain with us. And I am extremely pleased to recommend the following teachers to go on continuing contracts. Now, this means the probationary period is over. Ted DeMille in the elementary school, Mary Ellen Fagan, Leslie Knowlton, Julie Merrill, Warren Wilkinson, and David Shields. I have read the evaluations on everybody I'm presenting tonight, and I want to say that I'm
extremely pleased with the caliber and quality of the evaluations. Now, at least I've come off as sexist, I also want to say that I'm so pleased to see there are three young men on the elementary level, which I'm hopeful serves as role models. That's quite different, as we know. In the past, we've had very few men. And not only are they three men, their evaluations have been superb. In the middle school, Tony Boffa, our music man, Hope Brown, Margaret Lewis, and Claire Ramsbotham. And on the high school level, Raymond Cooper, social studies, Lucille Emery, Carrie Hall, Tor Nielsen, Kathleen Perez, Belinda Snell, guidance, Kristen Tripp, our young physical education. Now, those are the people that we're presenting this evening for continuing contracts. Also, these are people, 17, who are in the process or who will go on the career ladder. And as you recall our numbers, that's going to add a large number, a large percentage on the career ladder. Again, I want to say that I've watched these people for 2 years, and I'm extremely impressed with these people. I might add also, we put an ad in the paper last weekend for the anticipated jobs, and we are being swamped, and that's the word, swamped with applications.
Where do those applications come from?
All over.
All
Denver,
over.
Denver, name it.
That's all over.
Yeah. And why they're coming from those places, I don't know, that ad, but we're getting some thought that we won't put another one in for a while because it's taking all of my secretary's time to just file them and get them ready. May I go on to the next?
Why don't we vote first on the continuing contract features? Any discussion about these continuing contracts? If not, we'll entertain a motion.
So moved.
Second. Moved and seconded. Did you get it, Connie?
Yes.
All in favor? All opposed? That's unanimous. Now, the next group of teachers, Darrell, what are they being nominated for?
Now, consideration of the nomination of the second year probationary teachers. Now, these are probationary teachers that will be reevaluated again. Some came to us this year, some in the middle of the year. And they are Claire Rothenberg, who's half-time gifted and talented. Elizabeth Kelsey is a half-time French teacher at the middle school. Jill Blackwood, our half-time remedial reading and math. And Gretchen Berg, our half-time theater artist. On the high school level, Alfredo Paletti, Spanish, Thomas Truscott in Industrial Arts, and Madeline Garmy, who's our half-time nurse educator, and Thomas Hyland, our special education person, who will sail from Russia to America this summer with a Russian-American crew. And arrive on Labor Day, weather prevailing. I thought I'd add that because I was real impressed with his selection to that.
All right. Any discussion on second year probationary teachers? Not, can we have another motion?
So moved.
Second. Moved and seconded. The end. All in favor? All opposed? That's unanimous. Now, Mr. Superintendent, you have some potential staff reductions to tell us about?
Right. Now, I'm going to, pardon my being legalistic, but the Title 10A of the MRSA Section 13201. This is pursuant to staff reduction statute.
Let me just explain, since I'm a lawyer.
Fine, I'd be more happy.
MRSA is Maine Revised Statutes Annotated, and Title 10A has to do with education. So this is just a section of the education code of the state of Maine, the state law relating to education. And what does the state law say, Darren?
As lengthy as it is, we're going to be working this evening under Category B. It's other types of changes in local conditions. And I don't think that I need to read all this. I can paraphrase it.
Yeah.
When budget conditions are constraining in a community, or a grade is eliminated, or class size is reduced considerably, or the enrollment is declining, the school board, in good faith, can reduce the staff. Now, I want to say that we're extremely fortunate here because our staff is not reduced by seniority. Our staff is reduced by proficiency, foundation levels, the ability to be flexible to teach a wider band. But this evening, I'm asking the board to cut positions and not individuals. A month from now, I will come back and say, these are the individuals to be cut. They will be notified. This will be an executive session. And they have a chance to be here. And then they're given a 90-day notice by law. And I'm asking the board this evening to cut one position in the English department, 7 through 12. And I would ask the secretary to make certain that 7 through 12 for all of these, because that is the negotiated agreement of departments. One in social studies, one in the math department, and one in the science department. Now, we've lost over 100 young people in the last 2 years, and this certainly qualifies us to reduce these positions.
I'd like to interject there that in when I saw this, I did the sums of what the high school population is likely to look like based on our current enrollment. And I, as I recall, I'm not going to dig for it here, we should fall, just projecting those populations forward, to 430, in other words, an additional 40 or so students in the next couple of few years. And it wouldn't start to rise again for 6 or 7 years. So it's not just a temporary phenomenon, and it's ongoing.
Right. And it's interesting that we're going to be asking in the budget, perhaps for 4 or 5 additional teachers. So we're adding. We're maintaining the same population, losing at the high school, and getting it on the elementary and the middle school.
You know, that means that the high school will have just about half the number of students it had in its heyday back in the late 60s. Just about one half.
Yeah.
Cape Elizabeth at that time, incidentally, was a Class A for sports purposes. Class A played South Portland, and those schools, and had, I believe it was over 800 students in the high school. What a change. I think it's also important to point out to people in the audience, and at this point, it would be, I think, appropriate to observe that most of the people in the audience can see us, but we can't see them. But I think it would be important to point out that the elementary school now is growing in enrollment. So while we see reductions in staff 7 through 12, over the next several years, we will probably see some additions here and there in staff at the elementary level.
Right.
One of the things that, in as much as, you know, we're talking with the public here, we might answer is, why can't we better utilize the square footage of the high school? A number of people have said that to me, you know, it's there. The school was built 18 or 19 years ago, and it was built on a learning department concept. And those were the days when they were very extravagant with space. And the best example I can tell you is when you go to the gym or the auditorium or the cafeteria, that hallway, there's 151,000 square feet in that school. Now, you know, if you were to design a new high school today for 800, you'd be under 100 probably. Yeah.
But there was good reason for that in those days.
Yeah.
First of all, that hallway, where at least 200 kids had to squeeze in that hallway to smoke every other period. Is that true? They would jam into that place. It really wasn't quite big enough for all the smoking that was going on.
Well, they're certainly not doing that today.
No.
Well, I just brought that up. I thought I'd bring that up because it doesn't lend itself to housing other students.
Right.
Have they done any studies into what this is going to do to class size by taking these four teachers, one from each major area?
Yes, as a matter of fact, I've looked at that with the principal, and at the principal budget tomorrow evening, I'm going to ask him to bring his spreadsheets.
Okay.
So you will see what every teacher has in terms of numbers.
It sounds like it'd be wonderful, but unfortunately, you know, all 25 new additions don't fall into the same English class. You know, there's three or four there.
Right. Now, our job here is to decide whether we as a school board want to reduce one position in the English department, 7 through 12, all of these are 7 through 12, one in the social studies department, one in the math department, and one in the science department. Is there a motion to reduce those positions?
I move to eliminate four positions at the secondary level, one in English, one in social studies, one in the math department, and the fourth in the science department.
So second? Okay. Moved and seconded that we eliminate the four positions. All in favor, signify by raising your hand. All opposed, I'm for it. All opposed? Okay, and you'll come back and...
I'll come back with the staff members.
Yeah. All right. Now, the next item, Darrell, you say that we're not ready to have discussion of the school calendar because there's legislation pending that may affect the school calendar. Is that the extension of the school year legislation?
It's three things. Number one, it's the extension of the school year legislation. It's the very remarkable report that was made on early ed. And if that goes through, and that's receiving a great deal of publicity, and I have a meeting in Augusta on that tomorrow morning, that report is going to mandate primary teachers, K-3, to have staff development programs 3 days prior to school starting. The Human Services Department is earmarking 5 days prior to school for state workshops. So there's legislation that may, you know, alter our calendar. What I'm going to suggest, and I have the administrators presently working on it, I'd like to do a shell calendar where you have Christmas holidays, Easter, so when parents call in, they can get the plane reservations and all year ahead for the biggies. And then put in what I think the legislation will be, and then we'll alter it if we have to in the summer.
Could I suggest that you do a school calendar without the legislative changes in there, because the new laws, unless they're passed by two-thirds of the legislature, which is sometimes difficulty as emergency measures, regularly adopted legislation is not effective until 90 days after the legislature adjourns. The legislature is not scheduled to adjourn until July 1, so no law passed by this particular legislature that's in session now will be effective until October 1, unless it is passed as an emergency measure and two-thirds of the legislature votes to approve it. So if any of these are in the least bit controversial, you can be certain that they will not be law on Labor Day.
Then I think...
I would suggest that for our planning purposes, you're probably better off planning that those changes will come in the following year if they relate to the beginning of the school year.
Fine.
If they relate to something in January, they'll be law by January.
Is the state planning any funding for these programs?
The governor's program is calling for $4 million to add an additional one day. The problem with that is everybody, or a large number of the associations, are against it. They say, give us the $4 million. You know, we'll do something else. Most of the superintendents want staff development. The principals are against it. The elementary principals have come out wholly against it, and the secondary principals.
Okay, any questions about that?
Yes. I'd like to present some other business, a resignation.
Well, all right, is that time? Is it time for, we still have the library policy.
No, I'm sorry. Okay.
Sorry.
I'm sorry.
We had the last meeting, we had the first meeting of policies and procedures for selection of library materials. Not an unimportant policy, since one of the major areas of controversy for school departments across the country is what goes in their libraries and what doesn't get in the school libraries and who selects it. And we had a matter that came to the attention of the school board and the superintendent earlier this year with respect to some reading material that was available to third graders. In that case, the parents were very reasonable and rational about the thing, and we had good discussions with them, and I think the parents had some very good points. I think that it is important that we have a policy that that makes sense. And Darrell, can you summarize it without going through each item of the policy, but just say, I guess the question is, what rights do the media people in the schools have, you and the people that you employ to run the media centers, and then what would a parent do if a child came home with a book from the media center that the parents thought was totally inappropriate for children of that age?
Before he starts, may I ask a question? Is this different from the one we read before? Have there been any changes?
No.
Okay.
No. This is exactly. I'll just highlight the responsibility for selection is the first portion of this policy, and the objectives on materials selected. Then the School Library Bill of Rights for school library media programs. This is in line with that, and this is national and nationally respected. And it deals with a comprehensive collection of instructional materials, materials that support the curriculum, materials for teachers and students that encourage growth in knowledge, that develop libraries, cultural and aesthetic appreciation, and ethical standards, and a host of others. Then there's a criteria for selection of instructional materials that runs from the overall purpose to the reputation and the significance of the author, artist, composer, and what have you. Then there are special considerations when we're given gifts, what we accept, what kind of materials, how we look at that. And then we have a whole section on challenge material. If you want a challenge material, there are forms to fill out. And then we send this to a committee that examines, it's a review committee. And one of the things, the review of question material will be treated objectively in a very important manner. The best interests of the students and the curriculum and the school and the community shall be paramount consideration. This has been well worked by both all the administrators and the librarians. And it's very similar to what other schools are using, and it proves quite successful, and I think very timely. And I would hope that you would adopt it as policy, and we can put it in to the policy manual.
This means that any parent who finds anything truly objectionable has a process to have somebody decide whether the book belongs to him. Correct?
Yes.
All right. We've all read this. This is the second reading. Any further questions about it?
I was wondering if it was uncommon for the review committee to be composed of a school board member also. It seemed like the one instance we had was resolved by the school board chairman.
That's not altogether correct. Darryl resolved it, but I was involved in it.
Involved in it. Yeah. It seems like that would be...
I think the reason is that you are responsible for every bit of material that goes in the school. Now, it's done through the administration, but if you look at the law, you're responsible for the curriculum and all the materials. And I think it doesn't make sense to have you responsible by law and then have you reviewing what you're responsible for. I think that's the reason why board members have been left out. Also, if you look at the cases, it's always the board members that they take on. Ohio Supreme Court wouldn't let the people take the books off the shelf. Chelsea, of course, you know, Chelsea.
Okay.
The board was the one who sued that.
Any other questions? If not, it's time for a motion one way or the other on whether to adopt these library guidelines.
So moved.
Move to adopt. Second. All in favor? All opposed. Now, Darryl, you have some other business.
Yes, I'd like to present a letter of resignation and ask the board to recommend its acceptance. Effective July 1, I'm resigning my position of high school social studies instructor. This completes 22 years tenure at Cape Elizabeth High School. I'm retiring public education with 30 and a half years. I've enjoyed my years in Cape Elizabeth High School working with the staff and students and look back on many fond memories. Please have the necessary paperwork for the State Retirement Office and financial arrangements in order for the July 1 retirement date. Thank you for your forthcoming assistance. Very truly yours, Ronald Cole.
Do we have to take any action on that?
I would hope so, sir. I would recommend that...
What's the nature of the action?
To accept this gentleman's resignation.
Okay. Motion to accept?
So moved.
Second? Moved and seconded. All in favor of accepting the resignation? All opposed? Thank you. Anything else, Darryl?
Yes. I'd like to have confirmed, excuse me, the leveling tracking workshop with the board, which was originally established for Monday the 20th.
Yeah.
Is that still on?
No. No. That was why I had my notebook out here for the last couple of minutes. I have talked to a couple of board members, and then I decided that we were going to have to go back and forth. I was going to have to be back and forth with each board member about five times for these separate dates. It happens in all the years that I've been around here that we have more conflicts in the next 3 weeks than we've ever had. Now, I'm unfortunately not going to be in the state next Monday, and it's something that was just unavoidable. So that's when we had it scheduled for. Now I began to look for alternative dates. We have a budget workshop on the next night, Tuesday the 21st, so that's out. Wednesday's out, right? Thursday the 23rd.
Okay.
Is that right?
Thursday the 23rd.
Everybody said it's hard.
Hold on. That's Jan's surprise baby shower.
Do the people watching television know about the shower and where it is? Is this a surprise? Is this a surprise?
It isn't anymore.
All right. Now, that takes care of that week. Unfortunately, the next week, I am gone, out of state.
Okay.
I feel badly about that because it's something we get to get done. Now the next week, Peter is gone the entire week. The next week, Jan is gone.
What's the next week? You're having your baby.
The 10th. Do you have time for that baby yet? So we put that in work.
The only thing that Jan, she said that she would be willing to have it a little earlier. At this meeting. She didn't say that.
I did.
The fact is that then school vacation comes.
What about the week of the 24th?
Okay, I'm all for having it the week of the 24th, but first I want to ask Darryl a question. And let me tell you what my problem is on the 24th. The purpose of the workshop was for us to discuss and to hear from citizens about the concept of leveling and do we do too much, do we do too little, tracking students. How much of it exists in the elementary schools where we, you know, categorize the kids and place them at various levels. And how much in the middle school, and we know we do it in the high school. But in addition to that, we have the high school, the course book for the high school makes certain policy statements in it with respect to leveling. How many people are expected to be in each level, how one gets into a course, and so forth. And there was a letter from Frank Miles that went out to parents and a meeting with the Frank Miles and eighth grade students that I missed, but about this whole concept. And I think there were a lot of policy matters covered in it. Now, suppose, just for the moment, suppose that the school board, after the workshop and at a school board meeting subsequent to the workshop, said, well, we think that parents just, the statement was made 10 to 15 kids in the top level of English. Suppose the school board thought that as a matter of policy, that the arbitrary figure, a limit of 10 or 15 kids in number one top level English was too small a group. Would it be too late at the May meeting, for instance, to change that? Because all of this stuff goes out. Don't the kids sign up for the courses before that?
Yes.
So that would be too late.
I think they sign up Friday.
Friday.
It's Friday?
Friday.
So anything's too late. Although, would it be too late?
Couldn't
they redo it if there's a...
How does the school board get its oar in these things? I guess that's my question.
Well, let's go back. The school board hasn't changed its right to fail policy. That's a policy of the school board. No.
Well, there's nothing in any of these communications to parents that say anything about the school board policy. One would be surprised to know of that policy after reading the course book and after reading the letter.
And that's unfortunate. However, that's being said right now. Michael Ephraim knows of the policy, and Michael is talking at curriculum tonight at the high school. And naturally, that's going to come up. And I just spoke to him, and I said, you know, make sure you say what our policy is. Now, maybe we've got to get that out for children.
I think you do.
See, the people that are doing the selection are our concern are the eighth graders. Is it not? Isn't it the eighth grade selections that are? Is it ever? I don't know if it's everybody's selection by Friday. I know it's eighth graders.
It's eighth grade by Friday only.
Yeah, I think it's eighth grade only.
No, actually, I think that I don't know if it's the final selection, but I know the high schoolers are turning in their schedule choices tomorrow. But that's not the final, I mean, they don't necessarily get what they're asking for, and I think that's sometime in May.
Mr. Chairman, I don't see any reason why we couldn't, the principal will be in the morning, review that with him, and then review the selections. But and then we just may have to say that any youngster wanting a particular course has a right to take it. He just suffers the consequences of the course.
Well, I think there are a number of issues here. I read that, and I had the same reaction that I had when I began to hear that we were going to a middle school, now defined tonight as a true middle school. And there really hasn't been any deliberation at the board level as to what that means and when we're going to get there. By the same token, the memorandum that we read in our packet indicated that we were going to quite dramatically restructure the way our courses were offered. And I did not disagree with that description, but with one exception. But I didn't feel that we had really deliberated on it. When I read that there would be 10 or 15% in the top level, and knowing that there were slightly more than 100 in an average class, I wondered if we were approving smaller class sizes at the for the advanced placement courses. And I guess, to use Harold's expression, I didn't feel that we had gotten our oar in.
Yeah, I think it's a, Darryl, look, I think Peter's absolutely right. I've been around here 6 years, and I'd like to think these are important matters of education that really interest every single person on this board, no matter where they stand on the issue. They're of great interest, and they have enormous effect on our educational system.
Yep, I agree.
And it's hard for me to believe that all of this can be taking place and we're left totally out of the equation. We're not part of this process.
I think we're getting a lot of mixed messages. I hear what you're saying. Other people got just the opposite of what was said at that meeting that night.
Well, they may have, but we're the board, and we think we're being left out. Right. So when they get on the board, then they may not think they're left out.
Then I think, I think what happened there, and, you know, I wasn't here. What happened, this is the result of about 4 teacher meetings and the discussions that have come about with the principal. And before he left, I spoke to him and said, in no way are we changing the policy. Child has a right to fail. And he agreed. At no time did he say, I talked to the people. At no time did, but no time did he say that a person couldn't apply for any course he or she wants and have to suffer the consequences. And I think what he's trying to do, or as I understood it, he's trying to get all level courses, you know, to be more high-powered and developed around some kind of criteria where the teacher can hold to the criteria.
We don't question, I certainly don't question his motives. I ascribe to him the highest motives. But don't we have a right to ask some questions like, will this affect college admissions process? How will this impact on students? What does the research say about these things? It seems to me that we, as elected representatives of people, ought to be well informed.
I thought that was going to be the purpose of our workshop.
But the workshop comes after he's announced the policy. And there's no getting around that. Look, and we're not going to go anywhere, but there is no way to get around it. The workshop comes after he's announced the policy. What I'm trying to get at is a practical solution to this that will not cause anybody any great difficulty. I want the board to be able to ask questions about this, to have some input, to be able to develop some information and make up their minds about some aspects of this.
Why don't we meet the 16th? That's Thursday night. It seems to be very imminent.
16.
We can do that, but I just don't think it does the thing justice. I think it's just, I mean, we're just trying to...
No, so, I'm sorry.
I'm certainly not going to be prepared.
16th is my meeting with all of the Cumberland County legislators at the university. And this is a dinner meeting. I'm the chair. 17th, that's Friday. Excuse me?
He's not Irish.
St. Patrick's Day.
I think we should do it on the 24th, where we can do it without just feeling as though we're just going through the motions to get, so that we can say we did it.
24th.
And I think that, what I'd like to do, I don't know, why do they have to, let me ask you this, Darrell, why is it that this Friday they have to get these courses arranged for the freshmen?
I imagine it's just...
It's more convenient.
I think it's an arbitrary, yeah. You know, not, they said they should be in by such a date, it happened to be
yeah.
a call I got. Well, somebody said Friday.
I think they should delay it, frankly.
Well, are the class sizes going to be roughly equal?
I don't know. You'll see that tomorrow night.
Okay.
I think you'll see that tomorrow night.
And that's not the only question, obviously, but it's a question.
Sure.
I would object if there were only going to be 10 in a class and we hadn't been consulted.
I'm inclined to agree.
Or 15. But,
yeah. No, you're going to see that tomorrow evening. And I think there's an opportunity to ask all kinds of questions.
I understand, but it's not just us. It is people, that, you know, nobody knows this is going on.
Sure, we need a workshop, but I'm saying if we want to postpone that...
Well, we can ask
about it. We can ask tomorrow night. Say, why don't we postpone that?
Yeah.
Or one of the other selections.
Well, I think you're better than that, even. I think you're the superintendent of schools and the chief administrator of us. Why don't you say, Frank, look, we got a little problem here. We got a problem with a couple of board members. And I want you to figure out how we can get some board input on this thing before you kick off next year's schedule and put it in concrete.
Okay. Certainly isn't going to be in concrete this early.
Yeah, that's right. That's what I think.
Matter of fact, we don't even know some of the staff.
That's right. So will you do that tomorrow
and
help him to work through this? I know it's a pain in the neck for him, but these things happen.
Okay. No problem.
Is that satisfactory to everyone?
It's fine.
Peter? Satisfactory? Okay.
And that's our date, 24th.
Now, what month?
April.
Next October.
I have March and April.
Yeah, okay. That's a good question, but it is Monday, the 24th of April.
Okay.
At 7 p.m., I think, huh? Okay.
7 p.m.?
Yeah.
7. Okay.
Okay. Is there anything else that needs to come before the board?
Do you want to remind people, Mr. Chairman, of the budget workshop dates that are coming up so that if anybody wants to attend,
I'd
like to attend.
That's a very good idea. Tomorrow night is a budget workshop date.
Right.
And then next week on Tuesday night, 21st, is everybody straight on that one, the 21st, Tuesday night, budget workshop. Then Saturday, the 25th at 9 a.m., these are all held upstairs in this building, in the conference room right upstairs. That's Saturday, the 25th. Another one, Saturday, the 1st. And the 11th, is it? The 11th of April?
That's our next school board meeting.
Our next school board meeting is the 11th, yeah. Okay.
For the 10th, there is no meeting, April 10th.
One of the few days in which there's no meeting. Okay. If nothing further, I believe that the superintendent wants a motion to go into executive session to discuss personnel matters. Is there such a motion?
So moved.
Second. Okay, moved in second. All in favor of going into executive session for the purpose of discussing personnel matters? The vote. We're going into executive session.
You don't have that later.